Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today we're going to introduce acute and obtuse triangles in the framework of rational trigonometry. So here's a standard triangle, as usual, with its three quadrances and its three spreads. And we'll also say that this spread S1 is not just the spread between those two lines, but it's also the spread of the sector determined by those two lines and the interior of the triangle. In other words, that region of the plane which is between those two lines and on this side containing the triangle. All right, and we say that such a sector's spread, S1 say, is acute precisely when this inequality holds. Q2 plus Q3 is bigger than or equal to Q1. When this plus this quadrants is bigger than or equal to Q1. And conversely, we say that the spread S1 of the sector is obtuse when the opposite inequality holds, when Q2 plus Q3 is less than or equal to Q1. And our first observation is that we can restate these inequalities in terms of quadrances by the exact corresponding inequalities involving spreads. And that's because the ratio of the spreads to the quadrances is constant. That's our famous spread law. D is also the same as 4 times the circumquadrants of the triangle. And just for your information, I also restate that in terms of the quadria and the product of the quadrances. All right, now let's have a look at how the triangle spread rules allow us to rethink these inequalities. There are 2 triangle spread rules, and the one that's going to be of interest to us is the second rule, which tells us that in the situation we've been talking about, three spreads of a triangle, that the spread S1, say, is obtuse precisely when the other two spreads, S2 and S3, are first of all acute, and secondly, that they sum to something less than or equal to 1. Okay, so we're going to keep that in mind, and now we're going to define what we mean by an acute triangle. We say that the triangle A1, A2, A3 is acute precisely when each of its spreads is acute. It's just a standard kind of idea. And we say that it's an obtuse triangle precisely when it is not acute. In other words, when at least one of those spreads is obtuse. Well, it's not hard to see that at most one spread can be obtuse. So the triangle is obtuse precisely when one of its spreads is obtuse. And here is a kind of a restatement of what we've already determined, that the triangle A1, A2, A3 is acute precisely when these are now the conditions on the three spreads, not on the three quadrances. When S2 plus S3 is bigger than or equal to S1, when S1 plus S3 is bigger than or equal to S2, and S1 plus S2 is bigger than or equal to S3. So this is a direct consequence of that reformulation of the definition of acuteness we gave in the last slide. Now I just want to use the triangle spread rule to give another reformulation of the acute condition, that the triangle is acute precisely when three different inequalities. When S2 plus S3 is bigger than or equal to 1, and similarly S1 plus S3 is bigger than or equal to 1, and S1 plus S2 is bigger than or equal to 1. So how does this follow from the others? Well, first of all, if the triangle is acute, then all of its three spreads are acute. And from up here, that means that if S1 is, say, acute, and the other two are acute, then this inequality cannot be holding. In other words, S2 plus S3 had better be bigger than or equal to 1. And conversely, if these three inequalities hold, then these three inequalities hold because a spread is always in the number between 0 and 1. So if this sum is bigger than or equal to 1, then it's certainly bigger than or equal to S1, which is a number between 0 and 1, possibly 1. Right. So this implies this, and from here, this implies this. So just again a restatement, a slight restatement, where the inequalities are just a little bit different. And now let's have a look at the connection between this notion of acuteness and obtuseness and the circumcenter of the triangle. All right, now let's have a look at this following theorem called the Affine circumcenter theorem. It says that if we have a triangle A1, A2, A3, then the circumcenter C of that triangle can be expressed in the following affine combination. Gamma 1 times A1 plus gamma 2 A2 plus gamma 3 A3. where these gammas are numbers given explicitly in terms of the quadrances of the triangle and the quadria of the triangle by these expressions. So gamma 1 is Q1 times Q2 plus Q3 minus Q1. All of that divided by the quadria A. And similarly for gamma 2 and gamma 3. So, a note. The definition of the quadria of the triangle, I remind you, in terms of the quadrances of the triangle, is this one here. So this is the triple quad formula rewritten, everything brought to one side. This quantity is 16 times the square of the area if you want to connect it with something physical about the triangle. Now it's an interesting fact that this expression can be rewritten using just rearrangement as this plus this plus this. That's an interesting exercise, just to verify that. And these three quantities here are just the numerators that are appearing in gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3. Telling us that if we divide these three by the quadria, then necessarily their sum is 1. So these three numbers, gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3, sum to 1. So this is really an affine combination or a barycentric combination of the three points. And moreover, these three quantities here are exactly the three quantities that occur in the condition of the acuteness of the triangle. Okay, so the triangle is acute if this is positive, and this is positive. So the acuteness of the triangle is exactly equivalent to these three numbers being all positive. And if they're positive and they sum to 1, that means they all have to be between 0 and 1. So we're talking then about the situation where the circumcenter is actually a convex combination of the points A1, A2, A3. In other words, it's actually inside the triangle. So that's a direct consequence of this explicit formula for this barycentric combination. The explicit consequence is that the triangle is acute precisely when the circumcenter lies inside or on the triangle. Well, the proof of that theorem is an algebraic computation. We start off, as usual, with coordinatizing the three points A1, A2, A3. And then I remind you from one or two videos ago that the formula for the circumcenter in terms of these quantities is given by this kind of expression, where we're using our notation for antisymmetric polynomials. That's a big expression, a rational expression in all of these variables. And then another important ingredient is that the quadria of the triangle can also be expressed in terms of those coordinates, and it's given by this expression, which we write more efficiently like this, 4 times this particular antisymmetric combination squared. All right, so those are all the ingredients. Everything becomes just a computation involving these 6 variables, showing that the left-hand side is the corresponding affine combination of the three points themselves. And here is that, again, the consequence of this thing that we've already mentioned, that the triangle is acute precisely when the circumcenter C lies inside or on the triangle. So next time we're going to have a look at the proofs of the triangle spread rules. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.